Welcome back to the introduction to Hyper-V Jumpstart. I'm Simon Perriman, and I'm joined by Jeff Woolsey, and this module is going to be focusing on Hyper-V management.
Thank you very much, Simon. In fact, we're going to be spending quite a bit of time on System Center, so there will definitely be Hyper-V management in here. Let's dive right in. I'm actually going to leave a lot for System Center coming right up. So we are going to be talking about a number of different things. We've talked about Hyper-V Manager. I've actually walked through creating virtual machines. We've gone through the UI quite a bit. Creating virtual machines, OS support, management tools, PowerShell, security, remote FX. Let's dive right in. When it comes to management, you know, one of the challenges that we have with Server 2012 is that we actually have to be able to scale to a variety of different management paradigms. For example, I could be creating and setting up a server that's going to be a single server in a branch office, literally just one machine. Maybe it's going to run Hyper-V, maybe it's going to run a bunch of different roles and workloads, but it's going to run it on a single virtual on a single system. In that case, I need a management interface that's going to scale to be able to manage the demands of that single server. Or I could move slightly larger. Maybe I'm in a small and medium environment where I want to run maybe 2 to 3, maybe 4 servers in a small clustered environment, use shared storage to provide me high availability, to provide me ability to do automated cluster management, and to be able to do things a little bit more, but still to be able to do it in the confines of a very small deployment. Then if you take it up even larger, now you start talking about clusters or even multiple clusters or maybe multiple racks and data centers, now you start to talk to yet a third level and a different level of management and data center automation. And that's something that Simon's definitely going to be talking about and covering in the System Center aspect. But I just want to give you the insight that from our standpoint, it's really an interesting challenge that we have to be able to provide management solutions for all of those. So when it comes to Hyper-V, for example, we have the Hyper-V Manager, which is the local inbox UI for managing Hyper-V. Certainly, we've got WMI for programmatic interface. So if people want to be able to, you know, do some interesting things, they want to write their own custom, they want to be able to integrate it with an automation system or integrate it with their own systems management, WMI is certainly the way to do that. If you're an IT pro, obviously we've got things like PowerShell and the automation that we deliver through PowerShell automation. And then, of course, failover clustering management. When you start to move to a clustered environment, then you're going to manage things from the failover cluster UI. Because now once you've moved into this multi-machine environment where you want to be able to move things around, be able to orchestrate and manage patch management, you're going to want to be able to do that from the consistent cluster management interface. And then finally, there's the Remote Server Administration Toolkit, or RSAT. RSAT is a set of tools that allow you to run and manage from your client interface. So for example, if you go into Windows Server, you'll see the Hyper-V Manager, and you'll see the MMCs and all of the interfaces available there. Well, we provide those client utilities also for Windows clients, and you can run those to manage your servers remotely and not have to actually run anything at the box. So I've actually spent quite a bit of time already talking about Hyper-V, the Hyper-V Manager, the console, the Hyper-V VM settings. So I'm not going to spend too much. I'm not going to really go into that again. We've got the Hyper-V servers, the listing of virtual machines, the virtual machine actions. So there's a couple things I do want to drill back down to. So let's head back on over to Hyper-V. And there's a number of settings I do want to make sure that people are aware of. So first of all, one of the things I get asked quite a bit is, Jeff, if I want to manage a machine remotely, I know I can remote into the machine, but what if I wanted to have a number of servers actually here that appear through the Hyper-V Manager? So if I wanted to go here and say, let's connect to another server, and in fact, this server happens to be clear across about 5 miles that away. Lo and behold, I'll get access to a machine that's sitting in my office. So what I've done here is just added a machine that's sitting in my office, and in fact, I can manage that remotely as well. So if I wanted to keep adding machines here, I could do that, and if I want to remove that, I can do that as well. So when it comes to the Hyper-V settings, there's a couple of things I wanted to make sure we pointed out. So again, a common question we get asked about is, well, what about storage location, and how do I manage the default locations for that? Well, By default, we choose areas for storing virtual machines that are already safe. We know that from a security perspective are the right place to put them. But we also know that you're going to probably, if you're moving to a clustered environment, you're going to move it to a shared storage environment, whether it's for virtual fiber channel, whether it's iSCSI, whether it's the Windows Server 2012 file server. So we give you the granularity to do it for the virtual hard disks and the virtual machines. If you happen to be interested in RemoteFX, so RemoteFX allows us to provide the ability to access, to take GPU resources and place those into a virtual machine so that I can handle GPU acceleration from within the VM. You notice in this machine, I don't have any GPU options. And that happens to be because I'm running this on an older server that doesn't have a DX11 compatible video card. I will show you that on another one. But this is where you configure the GPU settings for RemoteFX. When it comes to live migration, we've got a number of different settings here that cover the live migration. These are some new settings that are also new to the Hyper-V UI. And when it comes to authentication, you can see we've got a number of different ways to do it. We can certainly use credential, cred SSP, which means you have to log in to perform the live migration. Or you can use Kerberos, which allows you to actually not have to require you to log directly into the machine, but then it needs you to configure constrained delegation so that your credentials can be securely used and travel across multiple hops as you do live migrations. Now again, we can do perform multiple simultaneous live migrations. This is where you can configure that. But we also wanted to take this a step further when it comes to configuration of live migrations. So in this case, I've set that I can accept a live migration coming from any available network. But if I wanted to, I could actually go to a very granular level and I could say, you know what, I'm going to specify the specific IP address range that I'm willing to accept live migrations. There are some people in some environments that are very concerned about security and may want to set aside a class of systems where they're willing to accept live migrations and to be able to do that on a very, very programmatic level. So we provided that capability in here. Storage migration, again, the ability to provide multiple storage migrations is also here. And by default, the number is 2 because we're actually very conservative when it comes to that number. But again, if you have more, if you have high performing storage and can handle easily more than 2, you want to do 4 or even more, you simply change that number. And what that changes is the queuing level for the live storage migration. So for example, if I set this to 4 and I perform 8 live storage migrations, it'll do 4 at a time and it'll queue the remaining storage migrations until those first 4 are done. Next, we've got Hyper-V Replica. Now, we're going to talk about this a little bit later, but the important thing to understand is this is where the global settings reside for Hyper-V Replica. This is where you configure the computer itself as a replica server, the types of authentication methods, whether you want to use Kerberos, whether you want a certificate-based authentication. And again, we're very prescriptive as about how you want to allow replication to be incoming. Do I want to allow it to happen from any server with my infrastructure, from any or specific servers that I want to specify within a specific trust group? So again, for regulatory, for compliance reasons, you may choose to set aside some specific servers that only replicate to another specific set of servers. For many, the replica defaults and being able to replicate freely is something that they want. But if you want that level of granularity, again, that's another thing we provide there. One question I get asked all the time is, is about the alt keys. So I want to take screenshots or I want to be able to take advantage of some of the alt keys within a virtual machine. Personally, one of the things I like to use is enable the use on the virtual machine only when running full screen option. So if I'm running full screen within the VM, then I can do things like take screenshots. If I'm not, I'm running in the Windows mode, then the alt actually applies to the host system. And those are really the changes, some of the enhancements that happen. The thing to understand here is these are the global settings. The Hyper-V settings here manage the entire server per se. Here we've got the virtual switch manager, and this is where I can manage virtual switches here on a per server basis. Now again, as you think about deploying in a cluster, or in a deployment across multiple servers, you're probably going to want to manage this at a much higher level. And Simon's going to be talking about that in Virtual Machine Manager. But again, if you've got, say, just two single servers that you want to participate in a small cluster or small grouping in a small medium branch office, and you want to configure those switches, this is where you can do that.
Now, I have a great question here. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people are really interested in Hyper-V Server, built on Server Core. So the question is, how do I get access to all of these management options from Windows Server Core?
Great question. So first of all, Hyper-V Server, as well as managing from Server 2012 as a core installation, is actually something you don't is not something you manage locally. In fact, let's take a quick peek on over there. So let me switch on over.
I know. What are you switching to here?
So I'm now switching to a machine, which is about 10 miles away, sitting in my office. And this is a standard desktop machine. This is a tower configuration, nothing special. Got a couple of direct attached storage, not attached to any SAN or any file servers. This is all locally attached storage. So So I've got a couple of different systems here. First of all, let's talk about the different management interfaces that are presented in Windows Server 2012 and the different deployment options that are available. This is actually a big change than anything we've had in the past. So for example, one of the things we really want you to focus on when it comes to management from here on out and deploying of servers is that we really think and we really want to encourage people to deploy Server 2012 with a minimal to no graphical user interface. People get very concerned when I say that. They're like, what does that exactly mean?
Well, people are afraid of the scripting. You know, they think I have to sit there with my command shell and just type commandlets, right?
There's a lot of people that look at that and go, what do you mean no local GUI? Let me switch.
Now, you know, while you're doing that, you know, yep. One of the other big benefits of Server Core that, you know, we really want to emphasize here is not only is it a smaller installation base, meaning, you know, smaller OS footprint, less storage space, but it's actually more secure because, simply put, there's less vulnerabilities, there's less code, less products. And so what this means for you as well is you could get higher availability on these Server Core installations simply because there's fewer components, which means fewer components need patches. Fewer patches, fewer reboots. And so this in turn means that if you deploy everything with Server Core, you're actually going to have to do a lot less patching. So this could be a great option for you to use in the long run.
So let me show you two different deployments of Server 2012. So first of all, let me show you a full deployment. So if you deploy Server 2012 using the full GUI like we've always had, you'll see here's Server Manager. Now I'm running a small compressed screen because this is in a VM. But here's Server Manager. Okay, I configure the local server. I configure firewall settings. I can configure the roles that are in the machine. I can configure storage spaces. I can configure storage pools. But this is the full graphical user interface that we're used to shipping with Server 2012. If you want, you can go run IE. You can run, you know, full on. You know, I've got my full on Explorer. I've got full on Shell. This is the way people are used to deploying Windows Server. And like I said, we still need to be able to provide this because there are going to be plenty of cases where in a small environment, this could be literally the only UI that you have. However, in Server 2012, we also introduced a new option. We also introduced a minimal GUI option. So in this one, you'll notice I've installed Windows Server 2012. But guess what else is here? Nothing. There's no shell, there's no IE. What you have is a command line interface, but you have Server Manager. So what we've actually done is we've created this new middle ground. So let me kind of explain how this has worked in the past. With Server 2008 R2, when you installed an operating system, at install time, you were asked a question. Do you want to do a core installation or do you want to do a full installation? A core OS means you literally get nothing but a command prompt, okay? So if you install core OS, it looks just like that. Okay, pretend that the Server Manager isn't running, but that's literally all you get. You can't do anything. There's no GUI, there's no nothing. You manage it completely remotely. And we like server core a lot because, as Simon mentioned, basically there's fewer things running and it reduces the patch footprint pretty significantly. We've dropped the number of patches by about half when you're running in a core configuration. We've been telling people to do this for quite a while. This is how we run a huge percentage of our infrastructure, and we like it a lot. In Server 2012, we changed this because what happened was in 2008 R2, it was an OS installation option. Basically, you installed 2008 R2 and you installed it as core. If you looked at this and you said, wow, this is great, but I'm scared by this because I don't know how to do anything locally and I'm not sure how to manage this remotely, and you decided you want to go back to the full GUI, you had to reinstall the OS. There was no way to go and switch and actually add components to bring you back to the full installation experience. In Server 2012, we've made this customizable and optional, and it's no longer an OS installation option. So what happens is, in this case, I installed Server 2012, and in fact, I installed the full version. I then went in and removed all the local UI. So here you'll see in Manage, you'll see we have the ability to add roles and features. So what I did was, I'm going to go in here and add. And the reason why I'm adding, of course, is because I've already removed it. Is right. Hold on. I am missing it. Where is it?
Almost there. In the meantime, while we get
oh,
this,
right here. Sorry.
Oh, you got it. Okay,
sorry.
Great.
It was staring at me right in the face. Here's the feature, the desktop experience in the server graphical shell. So if I want to bring the shell back, I can simply check this checkbox and install it, and now I can go back to the rich install shell that I'm used to. But in my case, what I did was I installed the full thing and uninstalled it. By doing that, what did I get? I've got this now this middle ground, which is something I actually like a lot. This is basically, I have a command line interface, but now I have Server Manager. With Server Manager, I can still manage a whole bunch of capabilities of this local server. For example, I can go into the local server, and I can configure things like IP address settings. I can configure the firewall. I can enable remote desktop. If I want to take advantage of the new NIC teaming capabilities, I can go in here and configure NIC teaming. And all of this is being done using the Server Manager. But again, I'm not carrying around things like IE or the full shell. So it gives us this nice middle ground. And then, of course, if I want to go back to the full, I can install the full GUI as well. So what this means is it gives me the ability to go from a core to a minimal to the full GUI experience. And it provides us a scalable management experience. Another thing I want to point out as I switch machines, sorry, there we go, as I go back on over here, is the fact that now we can do multi-machine management. So here right now, I'm logged into this machine beta 1. Server Manager has dramatically changed in 2012. In 2008 R2 and previously, Server Manager was basically something you did usually as a one-time option. You would install the operating system, you'd go to Server Manager, and you'd configure a couple things, but you'd never come back here. It didn't provide you an online dashboard for any eventing or things like that. Well, Server Manager in 2012 is dramatically different. Number one, I've got eventing right over here. So I can take a look, and I can see I've got some events that I can take a look at. I've got some services, and this tells me when my services has started, what's running, what is delayed start, and allows me to take a look at those. In addition, from a best practices standpoint, one of the things we want to do is make it easier to deploy a server and make it easier to ensure that you're running using our own best practices. So if you want to run the best practices analyzer, it'll actually run on top of this. I can start the BPA scan, it'll run across the entire server, it'll look at, oh, this is running Hyper-V, it'll look at the roles that'll built in, and it'll go through a whole bunch of laundry list of checklists that we've done on the Hyper-V team to ensure that our best practice analyzer is giving you the best guidance to meet the requirements of running Hyper-V. In addition, if you want to look at performance statistics, you can also do that. Now again, look at this. These are features and capabilities that we've built into the server manager that we've never had before. Usually in the past, you've had to add some additional eventing, additional monitoring, which obviously System Center does a fantastic job, but for those larger deployments. And again, a smaller shop, a 2-node, a 4-node, even a smaller 8-node shop, there's plenty of capabilities that are built right in here. So that's one great thing about it. Also, I want to point out that from this system, I can also manage machines remotely. So here I'm running, this is the machine I'm running, but let's say I want to add another system to manage. So I'm going to go in here, I'm going to add a server. And in fact, what I'm doing now is I'm actually able to manage additional machines. This is another machine sitting in my office, but I'm managing it for the first time from Server Manager. Server Manager has never had the ability to do remote management of other servers. It's always been about managing the local server. And in fact, if I want to do things, for example, it's telling me my performance counters aren't started. Well, guess what? It's simply a right click, go in here and start performance counters. So there's a tremendous amount of work we've done in Server Manager to provide that multi-machine management. All right. Let's go back on over here. Let's get to OS support. So one of the questions we get asked all the time is Hyper-V, are we just focused on Windows? Is that all we're shipping and is that all we support is guest operating systems? And wow, let's make sure everybody understands that's not the case, nor has that ever been the case. Since day one that we shipped Hyper-V, we've actually supported Linux and other operating systems for a very, very long time. Right now, we've got a very, very long list of all of the last many releases of Windows, whether it's on server, whether it's on client, 2012, 2008 R2, 2000, 2003. On the client side, 8.7, Vista, XP, SP2, we got you covered. Everything you're looking for is there. When it comes to Linux, we have long supported interoperability. We've actually done a tremendous amount of work to support the distros that you care about. In fact, the first thing we did was we asked you, what are the operating systems, what are the Linux distributions you want us to support? And by far and away, the two that everybody asked for were SUSE Linux and Red Hat. And after that, it was CentOS. And so what have we been doing over time is we've been adding additional support for these operating systems based on your requirements. But more importantly, we've been working with the Linux Foundation to get our drivers into the Linux kernel itself. I'm guessing there's a little shock going on right now. So let me kind of explain what that means. So what happens is, as the Linux kernel is developed, folks contribute drivers into the Linux kernel. Those drivers are GPL, including the Hyper-V drivers. They are actually in the mainline kernel today. So, for example, if you happen to go download the latest version of Red Hat or CentOS or SLES or whatever, and you happen to install it on Hyper-V, lo and behold, you don't need to go and install any additional drivers because the drivers are already included in Linux. And in fact, let me give you an example of just that. Here is an OS I literally just picked at random. Not even one that we go out of our way to say is supported or not supported. Hold on here. Helps if you pick the right one.
Now, while you get this set up, a question that I hear a lot from customers is, there's some things that we don't have on our list, such as Windows NT, Windows 2000.
Oh, yeah.
Which other hypervisor vendors say they're fully supported, but yeah, that doesn't seem to make sense. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah. I'm going to be nice, and I'm just going to kind of call that disingenuous. So let's be transparent about this. I hear this all the time. Vendor X says they support NT. That's interesting. We haven't supported NT in a very, very long time. I get Vendor X says they support DOS, Windows 3.1, Windows 95, 98. You can make those claims, but unfortunately, when the customer comes to us and says, great, I need a fix for NT, not that this has happened in a long time, but we have to say, sorry, we haven't supported this OS in many years. In fact, I actually have a real scenario where this happened. I had a customer come to me in the last 8 months, and they basically were in the process a long time ago of getting off 2000. And a certain virtualization vendor said, stay on Windows 2000, we'll support you. And instead of migrating to 2008 R2, spend those money on more virtualization licenses, which they decided to do. Unfortunately, when they started having some problems and they said that they needed 2000 support, that virtualization vendor sent it to us, which we had to tell them, We haven't supported 2000 now for many, many years. And it was unfortunately a very uncomfortable situation. So the important thing to understand is let's be very transparent. Okay? We're very clear about what we support. When it comes to OSs, we have a very clear support lifecycle. 2003 is in support till 2015, okay? But it is very much on the extended support list. Everybody's already doing the XP watch, okay? XP is very much coming to the end of its term. That's not going to change, okay? And we will happily support our OSs then or that are in mainstream and extended support. But once they fall out of extended support, that means it's not supported on any platform. Not virtualization, not physical, not anything. So the important thing is we want to understand, we want to make sure that you're in a supported configuration and a supported environment. Now the corollary to that is, so does that mean that I can't run NT on Hyper-V, or does that mean I can't run 2000 on Hyper-V? Not at all. In fact, you can go out and you can install 2000 and I can get NT to work, and I can probably make Windows 3.1 to work if I really wanted to try all my magic incantations. But at the end of the day, honestly, does that mean I'm going to put a support statement out there? No, we're not really interested in doing that. We really want to be transparent. We want to make sure we're focusing and supporting and testing in a very consistent way. So that's what we mean by that. So again, we're very clear. You can see we have supported guidelines for our operating systems, and that's all publicly available. So here's an operating system, and in fact, we quote unquote, here's a great example. Here's an OS, actually it's not on our compatibility list. It's Linux Mint. I literally just downloaded this, just for giggles. And guess what? This is Linux Mint. This just came out, this release just came out recently, and guess what? It has all of our integration services in here. So my storage connectivity is in here, my network connectivity is here, I have mouse integration. And the reason why is because what happens is the Linux distributions, they go to the Linux kernel, they go to Linus's kernel, they grab the kernel from Linus, and then they use that and they build on top of that. But that core Linux kernel is where we've been doing a ton of development. So you'll actually find the Linux integration services, our high-speed networking, our high-speed storage, our mouse integration, our keyboard integration, all of that stuff has been going into the Linux kernel itself. GPLv2, just like anyone else. And if you look, we've done a tremendous amount of work with the Kernel Foundation. In fact, I'd like to give a special shout out to Greg Koa Hartman in the Linux Foundation, because he's been a tremendous partner, because honestly, this was very new to us, and we wanted to make sure we were doing everything the way the community wants us to do. And really, Greg was a fantastic guy to help us kind of lead us through the process. And a couple times, we didn't understand everything correctly, and Greg called us on it, and we were happy to take care of that. But what the end result is, guess what? Here's Linux Mint. Here's Red Hat. Here's SUSE. Here's OpenSUSE. I'm going to switch on over to another one. So I just showed you Linux Mint, and here happens to be OpenSUSE 12. Did I do anything special? No, I literally downloaded an ISO file. I put it in the virtual machine, I installed it, and lo and behold, there's OpenSUSE. There's SLES 11. And lo and behold, it just works flawlessly with storage integration, network integration. So interoperability, again, is very key, and it's very important to us. And so it's all there, it's all goodness. All right.
So I mean, you mentioned this integration piece a couple of times. Mm-hmm. We have this concept of integration components. Can you go into detail of exactly what is an integration component?
Yes, let me do exactly that. So here we have, again, the work we've done, the supported operating systems, Linux on Hyper-V. We've got and by the way, all of the live migration capabilities, failover, all of those just work with Linux Guest as well. It's all completely transparent. Now, one of the things you do need to understand is after you install an operating system, there are integration services. Well, these are the things that we've been building into the Linux kernel itself. So when you install a modern Linux distro, these integration services are in there. If you're running, say, an older version of Windows, for example, Windows Vista or Windows XP, those integration services aren't built into Windows. So if you're running an older OS, this is kind of something you need to keep in mind, is there's really a couple steps to installing and creating a virtual machine. You walk through the wizard to create the VM, you give it its resources, you assign it CPU, memory, storage, networking, etc. You install the operating system, whether it's through Pixie Boot or an ISO or a CD-DVD. And then at the end, you need to make sure you have the integration services. The integration services are the high-speed drivers that we provide to give us the best performance, the best scale within the virtual machine. Other virtualization platforms have the same thing. Some of them call them tools, whatever they are. But they're basically tools. They're device drivers that run within the virtual machine to give you high-performance I/O. In Hyper-V, this is basically available through the UI itself. So people always ask me, do I need to download these? Are these available somewhere? These are actually part and parcel and built into Hyper-V. So we install an operating system, it'll say, insert the integration services disk. And you'll even see, once you insert the integration services disk, it'll walk you through a setup through an installer, quick reboot, and then you've got all the drivers in there. And it's just like, you know, you would have a driver for a network adapter or a storage adapter. These are simply the same types of device drivers you would have for mouse, keyboard, those types of things. So that's what's going on with integration services. Now, an interesting challenge when it comes to management is how do you deal with some, there are a couple of special cases of workloads out there that may have some special management requirements. A good example are domain controllers. If you've ever read any of the best practices on domain controllers, you will see the Active Directory team tell you up and down, forward and backward, always, always turn on a VM and turn it off. Don't save state it, don't snapshot it. The worst thing you can do to a domain controller is to roll it backward and forward in time. Domain controllers do not like that. And so this is an area that can create an additional management headache, because maybe your team knows how this works and they know the best practices and they know that, and that's not a problem. But what if you are new to this and someone actually does save state a VM that's running a domain controller? Or what if you have an emergency situation and you need to be able to do this? Are you going to cause problems down the line? In addition, what if we actually used the ability to clone domain controllers as a way to actually deploy domain controllers faster? And so what we did in this release was we spent a lot of time with the Active Directory team. Again, huge kudos to the AD team. And we wanted to figure out, how do we solve this problem? This is an incredibly difficult nut to crack, and there's no one in the industry that can solve it better than us. So we looked at, what are the requirements, what are the issues that we need to deal with in terms of rolling domain controllers forward and back in time, and how do we help ensure that you don't get in a situation that you don't want to be in with a domain controller? So what we've done is we've actually added some new capabilities through a feature called the VM Generation ID. With Server 2012, for the first time ever, not only do we support, not only your domain controller is a first-class citizen, but we actually tell you you can clone domain controllers and use this as a way to quickly deploy domain controllers using Hyper-V. So a couple things that are key to understanding about this. Number one, you must be running Windows Server 2012, because these are changes we made to the hypervisor itself in 2012 that allow us to better integrate with Active Directory to make sure that we can notify AD when a VM is going in and out of a safe state or when it's been snapshotted or cloned. A key part of that is giving AD the understanding to know when this situation has occurred so it can do the right things and to ensure that you don't cause any corruption in the rest of the system. The PDC emulator role must be online and available when running Windows Server 2012. You must be a member of the clonable domain controllers group in AD. So again, they wanted to make sure this wasn't something, you know, we don't just deliver a feature and then just say, by the way, anybody can play with this feature. We want to make sure that Active Directory admins are the ones that know, hey, if they're going to deploy this and they want to do this, great. And you want the ability to delegate that to a specific set of administrators. We want to give you that granularity when it comes to administrative management. So that's another key thing in there. And of course, this is available through the UI, or if you'd like to do all of this through PowerShell, that's also available as well. So that's a key capability in allowing you to quickly clone domain controllers, something we have never advocated before, is now actually something we can deliver in a great way in Server 2012. So when it comes to management tools, one of the questions I get asked all the time is, so, and I know you're going to cover this in System Center, but there's a variety of different tools to manage Hyper-V. When should I use the Hyper-V manager? When should I use the failover cluster manager? When should I use, you know, there's a lot of good questions in here. So let's talk about the failover cluster manager. And again, we're going to talk about clustering and live migration in a sec, but here's the thing to understand. Forget about Hyper-V for a second. Put Hyper-V off to the side. So we under kind of let's assume for a second you're creating a clusterable file server, or you're creating a clusterable, you know, print server, or clusterable insert feature or role here. Well, once you do that, you're going to manage it from the failover cluster manager. Failover cluster manager is one of has been a key part of a Windows Server that has actually done multi-machine management for many releases, and it has only gotten better and more robust through each release. In 2012 is another great example of that. Well, if you think about that paradigm and add Hyper-V to it, it kind of all makes sense now. If you're running Hyper-V in a failover cluster, and you're not using VMM, because again, you're in a small environment, maybe just a couple servers and some shared storage or a file server, then use the failover cluster manager. Once you created the cluster, manage it using the failover cluster manager. And in fact, if you want to modify VMs, create VMs, change VM settings, there's actually that ability to do that from the failover cluster manager. So if you're in a cluster, use the failover cluster manager. If you're not in a cluster, use the Hyper-V manager. It's really that simple. And of course, once you've outgrown both of those things and you want to go to, you know, multiple, you know, many, many servers, maybe, you know, 6, 8, even more racks of servers, then you're going to go to VMM. PowerShell. So if there's anything I want you to understand to help make your resume better, in addition to Hyper-V and private cloud knowledge, is Windows PowerShell. We have made a huge investment in PowerShell in Server 2012. And let me give you quickly explain how that has jumped. In Server 2008, we introduced PowerShell. On the whole, you know, there was maybe 100 PowerShell commandlets total. Very difficult. It was a challenge. It could be done, but it was pretty much a challenge to do management of 2008. 2008 R2, we added some more, but it was still in the single, you know, in the hundreds. In Server 2012, Hyper-V alone has over 150 PowerShell commandlets. Hyper-V alone. Windows Server 2012 all up has over 2,400 PowerShell commandlets. So if you want to create VMs, you want to start VMs, you want to stop VMs, you want to allocate storage, you want to be able to create 20 VMs and allocate, give them, you know, assign them all 4 NICs, assign multiple VLANs, you can do all of that from PowerShell. It's all fully documented on technet.microsoft.com. But the important thing to understand is we're making a huge investment in PowerShell because we think that this is the way to get to private, to get to cloud is through automation. What you need to understand is people, if you want to manage at cloud scale, if you want to do, you know, massive deployments, you're not going to walk up to a server anymore. You're not going to log in and, hey, I'm going to remote desktop to a single server to do that management. You're actually going to do that remotely, either using System Center, or if you want to do it through automation, it's going to be PowerShell.
Now, I think an important part to add to this piece of automation is ensure that all of your hardware has some programmatic interface, even if it's not PowerShell, some type of script and language. And the reason for this, when we try to think of this model of a private cloud, this automation, this rapid elasticity, we need to be able to communicate with that piece of storage equipment, that networking equipment, automatically. If you're stuck using a graphical user interface, going click, 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 that breaks your automation. So as you continue to look at new hardware investments in the future, always find things that have this this script, some type of interface that we can directly communicate with.
Now, PowerShell is our mechanism for IT pros to do automation, orchestration, scripting, all of that. If you're a developer, you may be thinking, well, that's great for the IT pros, but I want to be able to do things, you know, give me a programmatic interface. Well, WMI is the way to do it. WMI is our implementation of SIM. We're very much an active participant in the DMTF, but WMI is how we can, if you want the programmatic interface to Windows Server and Windows, this is how you do it. And this is fully documented on MSDN. So keep in mind, we've got both levels of management capabilities there. From a remote server administration toolkit. So one of the questions I get is, well, Jeff, I've got a laptop and I've got a server sitting over there in the corner. Or maybe it's running Hyper-V server. Or I want to just manage this mostly from my desktop. How do I do that? Well, you can download the RSAT, the Remote Server Administration Toolkit. And what the Remote Server Administration Toolkit does is essentially gives you Server Manager for Windows 8. So on this system,
and you know, while you switch over, yep, I want to highlight one other point as well. Remote Server Administrator Tools works great on Server Core. Works great on Hyper-V servers. So if you're worried about, hey, I have server core and I'm stuck using this command line, this command shell, PowerShell, not at all the case. Connect remotely, use an RSAT, you get the full graphical user interface, connect into that core installation.
So here, I've got server 2012, but if this was Windows 8, I could install RSAT, and RSAT would give me the server manager. It would give me the server components here. It would give me all of these tools. It would give me the ability to add and remove roles, gives me the ability to add and remove features, do all of this remotely, gives me component management, computer management, Hyper-V manager, local, all of these things that you see here in the server. We provide these as a downloadable remote server administration toolkit that you can install on Windows 8 client. And we've done this for many, many years. And just so you know, we always match the server and guest, server and client. So when Vista came out and server 2008 came out, we had RSAT for Vista. When Windows 7 came out and server 2008 R2 came out, we had RSAT for Windows 7. Now with server 2012, we released the RSAT for Windows 8. We always keep those in sync. And the reason why we do is because we always are upgrading the management protocols in there between. And so this allows us to provide a very consistent management experience. But what it means is now, I can do a whole bunch of management. I can take advantage of Server Manager even on my Windows 8 client, desktop, laptop, tablet, etc. Last thing I want to get to is security. Now, security in and of itself, easily an hour or two talk. But there's a bunch of things I really wanted to make sure we covered and really kind of make sure that people understand about some of our best practices from a security perspective. It's very interesting to see how people can get laser focused on what the latest article is on their favorite web blog. Oh my goodness, there's something really horrifically bad going on over here. We certainly get that. But very honestly, the biggest problems we see are people aren't doing the fundamentals. They really aren't doing the fundamentals. It's, you know, we have an annual Microsoft report that we do out on security, and I believe it's over 99% of the security issues out there we've already had patches for. They're already out there. We've already released them. They're done. But they have to be deployed. And we can't go to every server and do that because, first of all, you know, people set corporate policy in place to deploy patches on their own scheme. Some of them do it with good reason. Some of them just are afraid and don't. But the important thing to understand is these patches almost always are already readily available. And so we want to make sure that people understand, you know, we understand the fixation around security and what the latest industry buzz is, but we've got to get the fundamentals in place. So with that, let's talk a little bit about security. So we mentioned this a little bit about already, but I want to mention this again. When it comes to Windows Server, again, it's a blank slate. And how much or how little you want to run is really up to you. Our best practice is really simple. Install Windows Server, enable the Hyper-V role, manage it remotely. Never touch the box. It's real simple. And in fact, use Server Core. And we've made it even easier now. If you want to install Server 2012 with a full installation, full GUI, and then remove it and go back to a core and then manage it remotely, go for it. But really, fewer patches, less third-party code, and most importantly, It's even more than that. It's about the temptation to install other applications. Okay, I was talking with a few customers recently, and I'm shocked when I find out what people are doing on their servers. Okay, when someone says they're browsing the web, that's the tip of the iceberg. When someone tells me they're running QuickBooks on their server, they're running Acrobat on their server. They're running, you know, insert random product here. Why are you running this on the server? Forget about Hyper-V. Why are you running this on the server in the first place? That's one of those, you need to have your server admin keys pulled from you. You need to go, someone needs to take a timeout, okay? You need to make sure you understand. The best practice for any server is configure it for what you're gonna do and manage it remotely. And don't be installing random stuff on your box. It's really that simple. Keep the parent for Hyper-V only. Don't install other roles. People always ask me, can I run the domain controller on the parent partition? Can I run the file server? Can I run the print server? Insert other role here. Run those in VMs. In fact, that's one of the things that guided us to make sure that Server 2012 provided a great solution for running domain controllers in a VM. On top of that, you can now run your domain controllers in a VM on a failover cluster, because the failover clustering team, Hyper-V and Active Directory, all got together to make sure that you can run everything, all of your domain controllers virtualized, and your failover cluster will still come back up even when the domain controllers are running inside the cluster itself. So we've done some dramatically awesome things here to make sure that we could give you a great private cloud story. Don't install other roles, don't install third-party programs, don't browse the web, and again, that's on any server. Keep the parent up to date. It's simple, it's obvious, it's important. We really want to make sure, like I said, the patches are out there, but you need to install them. And we give you a variety of ways to do it, both free as well as comprehensive management solutions in System Center. So for example, Windows Update is built into Windows and Windows Server. If you just want to turn it on and let us manage it, go for it. If you want to use Windows Server Update services, that's a role built into Windows Server. In fact, run that in a VM. It's a great workload to run in a VM to actually patch your infrastructure. Do that. That's built into Windows Server. Or if you want to, if you're in a larger environment, you want to use System Center, you can use System Center Configuration Manager, System Center VMM, and System Center basically to provide you patch coverage for your clients and servers. The important thing to understand is, look, folks, there is no such thing as perfect code. It really isn't. There's always going to be patches. So let's make sure we can do everything we can to keep them up to date. Delegate administration. So one of the things I see people do is they tend to, I'm going to be the Uber admin of the box. Well, you know what? I want Simon over here to have access to some virtual machines. So people will, hey, let's just give Simon access, full access to the entire machine. Well, you actually don't need to do that anymore. In fact, one of the changes we made in Server 2012 was to make it really easy to delegate administration. So for example, here, I'm going to go over here to computer management. And so I'm the admin on this server. Okay, I just created this server, and under local users and groups, you'll see there's the group here that's administrators. Okay, I'm a full admin on the box. But you know what? I'd like Simon to be able to create virtual machines, and I'd like him to be able to manage his own virtual machines. Well, we've provided delegated access for a long time, but you know what? We wanted to make it really easy. So if you'll notice in Server 2012, lo and behold, there's a new administrators group called Hyper-V Administrators. So if I go in here, I can make Simon an Hyper-V admin. What this means is he can be an admin of Hyper-V. He can't do anything on the box. He's not admin on the box. He can't go in and make changes to device drivers. He can't go in and make global changes to the system because he doesn't have that level of privilege. So we're providing an easy way to do delegated admins for Hyper-V administrators. So highly recommend you take a look at that. Now, if you're looking at that going, wow, that's really cool, but you know what, Jeff? I've got multiple levels. Maybe, you know, I've got multiple levels of admins. Then guess what? System Center does that. You want to get into very granular details and delegation of administration, you can absolutely do that as well with System Center VMM. But we made it really easy to do this first level of delegation in the box. Keep your guests up to date. Sound kind of familiar? Yes. So make sure, obviously you want to keep your parent operating system, your host operating system up to date, but you also want to keep your guests up to date as well. Same solutions are all there. Windows Update, built into Windows, Windows Server, Server Update Services. Again, a great thing to run in a Hyper-V VM. You can use it to patch your infrastructure, and System Center can manage and patch both your servers and your clients. Windows Server Compliance Manager. So one of the things I get asked about all the time is, listen, I want to make sure I have a centralized security baseline for my Hyper-V servers. And I want to make sure that all of my servers match this baseline. And I want to actually, is there a way that you can help me plan and operate and deploy these security baselines? We've actually been doing this for quite a while in Security Compliance Manager. In fact, we work very closely with the government. With the government, we actually sit down a couple times a year and go over best practices, and we make sure that we're constantly providing feedback, and we give them that feedback into how they deploy those servers and how they deploy that infrastructure. And a lot of that comes from learnings we've had in the Compliance Manager, and it's an ongoing compliance tool that's a free download from technet.microsoft.com. So a number of changes there. I know we're coming close on the end of time here. One last thing, remote FX. So when it comes to management, one of the things you do have to think about is, how do I want to manage remote FX, and what does remote FX provide me in a VDI environment? So one of the things that we've seen with VDI is people still want a rich, full fidelity experience. Not only do they want a full fidelity experience, but they want that experience to work with any device. And as we consume more and more touch-enabled devices, whether it's, you know, laptops, desktops, Ultrabooks, Surfaces, you name it, I want to be able to take advantage of that touchability, and I want those capabilities as part of the remoting experience. So in remote FX in Server 2012, we've made some huge advancements in the remote FX protocol. First of all, we have both a hardware and a software GPU. In Server 2008 R2, it was only a hardware GPU. And, you know, a lot of people liked the fact that we could take the GPU capabilities and provide that in a virtual machine. But a bunch of folks said, you know, I would actually like it if you could do it through software as well, because there may be many cases where that will provide an adequate capability within the virtual machine. So we've done and provided both hardware and software GPU. We also do adaptive graphics. Here's the important thing to understand when I say adaptive graphics. You can now do RDP over WAN, okay? So think about it. For the longest time, we've always said remote desktop is a fantastic solution on a LAN. And we've optimized for that experience. And a lot of people have said, yeah, we like that, but we really wish you'd kind of push the pendulum the other way, and we really would like to have an experience over WAN. So we spent a lot of time with adaptive graphics, with adaptive compression techniques, and new capabilities that allow remote FX to actually work over a WAN for the first time ever. Support for multi-touch. Again, as we move to a world of touch-enabled devices, people expect that they can be able to use those management to use these touch-enabled devices, but that remote FX and my remoting protocol will somehow be able to take advantage of all that. That is all built into Windows 8 and Server 2012. So now, for example, you can use your Surface, you can use your Surface and remotely access resources. Those VMs can be running on the back end, and guess what? Full touch support is in there with USB redirection and media remoting. So again, there's a whole bunch of changes that have happened here in terms of remote FX. So, number of takeaways, don't forget, there are a number of different ways to manage Hyper-V. Server tools, client tools, scripting, and remote management. And I know a lot of people, you know, look at that and go, wow, that sounds complex. Well, yes and no. It can be, but the goal here is we provide literally servers to, you know, we provide three quarters of the servers for the world. And we've got to make sure that we provide all sorts of different types of experiences and all different types of scale of deployment, whether it's one server, 10 server, 20 servers, 20,000 servers, or hundreds of thousands of servers running millions of VMs on top of that, we've got to be able to scale all of those. So that's why we provide different management tools. Also remember, when you're using and you're running in a failover cluster environment, if you're not using VMM, use the failover cluster manager. We'll take and allow that to do your management there. And Simon's going to get to that in just a second, so we'll get to that. And then finally, System Center. System Center, if you're doing, you know, you've got more than, say, a handful of servers, you know, System Center is going to give you far and away a much more complete, comprehensive solution when it comes to systems management. So with that, Simon, I hope you're ready, because you're going to be up real soon here.
Big session coming up.
Big session for you.
So stay tuned, and next we're going to be talking all about high availability and clustering.